right, you can be seated. Hey, thanks so much for being here today. We're beginning a series called Multiple Choice, and all of us at different times, and some of us all the time, are facing opportunities to choose and what we should choose. And as I was thinking this week, isn't it great that we have a God that gives us the freedom to choose? And he's not a dictator, or he doesn't necessarily impose his will on us, but instead we have this space to choose. Today, maybe we can call that the grace space. And God's grace gives us space to choose how we live our lives and what we're up to in life. And that's just a great benefit of being a believer in Jesus Christ. Now, hopefully in this series, if you'll stay with us, we'll help you in the decision and the choice-making process, the decision-making process. And you'll see that grace space kind of take place as you are able to make choices that honor God and as you see him work in your life. Now, I had to make a choice a few weeks ago. It was kind of one of those embarrassing situations that you want to correct. Our little two-year-old girl was sick, and I took her to one of these aftercare centers. And we got there. There wasn't any patients there. It was just us. And we walked in. We checked in with the receptionist. And she said, "What's wrong?" And I said, "She has stomach issues." And, you know, I just kind of told her the deal. And so we went back into the room. Now, it was a small room, but we couldn't see the receptionist. And she couldn't see us, but we could hear her. And she could hear us. That was kind of the situation we were in. And so when she got on the phone, I could hear what she was saying. And I'm sure she could hear what we were saying, just standing there or sitting there with my daughter. Well, again, my daughter's sick, and she had gas. Let's just put it that way. And it's that kind of guys in the locker room kind of gas that anybody could hear that was in the vicinity, you know, in the zip code, they could probably have heard it. And so the first time I'm thinking, man, what do I do? Because this lady can't see who did it, but she can certainly hear what took place. And so the first time I just kind of let it go, and I said, maybe she was busy and didn't hear it. But my daughter did it again. And again, it's the locker room guy kind of stuff, you know, that just reverberates, and you're thinking, what do I do now? And so as a dad, I had to jump in and figure out, how do I blame this on my daughter, you know? And in that outside kind of voice, I said, "Carrington, gosh, that's bad, girl. What's wrong with you?" You know, I blamed it on her. But that's the kind of choices we make in life, right? Hopefully we make godly choices and choices that honor God. Now today what we want to talk about is, if you got your outline, you can notice there, who do we listen to? That's the choice that we want to talk about today. Who is it that I let advise me? Who is it that I let influence me? And who is it that I let counsel me? Working with people for a number of years now, that's one of those issues that I think, at least I rub up against quite often. When you talk to people and you hear their issue or you hear what they're going through, it really quickly becomes, who are you listening to? Who's advising you through this situation? Who are you getting counsel from? Who are you letting influence you? Over the years, that's one of the questions that I ask when I sit down with people and they say, you know what, I've got this going on and it's starting to interrupt my life. I say, well, who are you listening to? Who do you let counsel you? Who do you let advise you? Who do you take advice from? Some of us are just inherently blessed by the family we were born into. And you say, well, thank God I'm able to just go to my mom. Or I'm able to go to my dad. Or some of you may look at your kids and say, man, my kids give great advice. And that's a huge blessing. But for all of us, it's just, it doesn't matter. And I was thinking about this earlier. It doesn't matter what age we are, you know. It doesn't matter if we're 80 or if we're 15. It matters who we listen to. Who we let kind of speak into our heart. Who is it that we take advice from? The little quote that I wrote down here, you can write this down if you want to. Who we listen to impacts where and how far we go. Who we listen to impacts where and how far we go. The people that I give the right to speak into my heart often those are the people that have some impact on where I go and what I do when I get there. Today, maybe you're a student. Maybe you're going into high school or middle school or elementary school, and maybe you're about to start school, as many people are. One of the big questions that you probably ought to think about is, who am I going to listen to? Who am I going to let advise me this year? Who's going to have the opportunity to counsel me or to influence me? Maybe you're in the corporate world. And from time to time it comes up that you kind of have to make a decision that it's a gray area. And you think, I need some advice. Well, who are you going to listen to? Maybe you're married. And you have a marital question. It's important who you go ask. It's important who advises you. It's important who you give the right to speak into your life in any circumstance. And so today, that's what we want to jump into. Who do we listen to? And we couldn't probably pick a better guy than the guy that is writing what we are looking at today. God used a guy named Solomon to talk to us. And he didn't just talk thousands of years ago. He's talking today. Because the words that you're going to see and what we're going to kind of figure out today is that Solomon spoke to me in 2013 just like he spoke to people a couple thousand years ago. Because these words are so accurate and apropos for where we're all at. And there's a couple interesting facets about Solomon. First of all, he was an accomplished guy. You may know that or you may not. He had achieved, very wealthy guy, most wealthy guy in that time frame. He had over 700 wives and concubines. Now, if anybody could give advice on relationships, that's the guy, right? 700 wives and concubines. And I'll stop. But there you go. He had 700 wives and concubines. He became king. His dad, David, was king. God said, okay, David, it's the end of your reign here. And Solomon became king. And many people consider Solomon one of the wisest men to ever live. And so what he's going to share with us today is some really good advice on who do we listen to? Who are you taking advice from? Who are you letting speak into your life? So before we jump in, let's pray and ask God to help us. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you that it can just help us. It meets us in any need that we have. Lord, we just pray today that as we open up your word, that you'll help us to just take from it. Speak to our lives wherever we're at and help us in this whole process of who advises us and who do we listen to. Father, we give you praise today. We thank you in Christ's name. Amen. All right. Number one, there's a couple criteria for the advisors in your life. And let me start off by saying these are just some guidelines for us to follow. You say, well, I have people that love me and care for me. And yeah, they may not have all of these. What should I do with them? Hey, listen to them, no doubt. But there's certain criteria that God would love for us to grab onto when it comes to advisors. And it doesn't mean kicking people out of your life. It doesn't mean kicking your husband out. It doesn't mean kicking your wife out. None of that kind of thing. What it does mean is that there's some criteria that God puts in place that would certainly help as we're listening to people's advice. Number one, they know your heart. They know your heart. If you've got your outline or you're opening your Bible, notice what we find here under point number one. They know your heart. It says the right word at the right time is like precious gold set in silver. So let's walk through this. Notice what we see first, the right word at the right time. Now, for somebody to give you the right word at the right time, what do they have to have? They have to know you. They have to understand you. They have to get you. They have to know your values and your heart. For it to be the right word at the right time, that means they're in close proximity to you. That they get you. You're different than I am. I'm different than you are. And there are certain people that realize those differences and they're able to speak the right word at the right time. How many of you have ever been going through something and somebody said a word or a phrase or maybe even a phone call that when you got off that phone call or got out of that conversation, you thought, they knew exactly what was going on with me. Anybody? Where you say, man, they just kind of had it all. They knew exactly what was going on. And that's what God is saying, the right word at the right time. These are the people that know your heart. Look what he says about the value of that. It says it's like precious gold set in silver. One of the things I love about the Bible is that it puts things in perspective incredibly well. If you were to ask me today, would you rather have a right word at the right time or a handful of gold? What do you think I'd choose? Probably the handful of gold, right? I mean, seriously, I mean, that's probably what I would do. If you walk up afterwards and you said, hey, I got the right word at the right time, do you want that or you want this handful of gold? Gosh, I'm probably going to choose the gold. However, you notice how the Bible puts it in perspective, though? He says that the right word at the right time is worth more than that gold. God says that that person coming that knows your heart, understands where you're at, giving you this timely word, that's more valuable than gold. My grandfather was a man of few words. And he probably, seriously, and I'm not trying to overstate this by any means, I probably had less than 5 real conversations with him, where you get heart to heart in the whole time he was alive. He was a man of few words, one of the World War II kind of guys that just didn't say a lot, you know. But 20 years ago, I actually sat in the back of this auditorium and I just knew that God wanted me to do something, you know. I just felt like he wanted me to do something. And during that time, the response was kind of interesting because there's no, I mean, I didn't grow up wanting to be a pastor. I didn't grow up wanting to be part of a church like I am now or any of that kind of stuff. And so it just kind of came out of the blue. I mean, it came out of the blue for me, but it also came out of the blue for the people around me. And I remember during that time, I almost hated to tell people, hey, I think God wants me to do ministry. I think he wants me to go into ministry. And I remember the response, really, you? What do you mean? That just doesn't make sense. And it wasn't that I couldn't do it or any of those kind of things. It just didn't fit. And I remember one day, for some reason, I was in the car with my grandfather. And I don't remember any other time that I was ever in the car with him. But I was in the car with him. And again, he's quiet, not saying anything. We're just kind of just sitting there. And all of a sudden, he looks over at me and with that kind of sincere, emotional kind of verbiage, he says, hey, boy, I'm proud of you. I'm proud of you. And that was such a right word at the right time. If you were to bring me a handful of gold right now and say, would you rather have those words or a handful of gold? I'm going to take those words. The right word at the right time. The first thing that we want to know when we're taking advice from people, we want them to be sure they know your heart. Now, let me tell you something that we talk about from time to time here, and it makes so much sense in this on this topic. Salvation is when we come into a relationship with Christ and we say, you know, I want to be in your family, God. I want you to be my Savior. I want to go to heaven when I die. That's salvation. That's that decision we make. That's that choice we make. It just changes the rest of our life. After that, there's a process called sanctification. And sanctification is when God begins to mold us into the image of Christ. That's called sanctification. One of the ways that happens is through the people around us. The people around us can often help us become more and more like Christ. In my life, my mom has been big in that area. My wife is huge in that area. I have friends that are huge in that area. It's just this sense that they help me move closer and closer in my relationship with Christ. And you say, why is it so important who I let advise me? Well, that's it. Because the people that advise us are going to help move us in one direction or the other. Does that make sense? The people that we let influence us, they're moving us in one direction or the other. And so when you're letting people advise you, it's so much more valuable to have those that are moving you in the direction of Christ. So when you're choosing advisors, when you're choosing counselors, first of all, let them know, hopefully they know your heart. Number two, they share godly wisdom. They share godly wisdom. Notice on your outline here, this next verse. It says, like an earring of gold or an ornament of fine gold is a wise man's rebuke to a listening ear. I highlighted those two words, wise man's. One of those critical, critical kind of decisions and choices we make is this. Are we listening to wise people? Are we listening to people that are bringing godly wisdom? Are we listening to people, again, like we said earlier, that are helping me move in the direction of Christ? And one of the standards you should use, probably, when you let people advise you, when you let people influence you, is this right here. Are they moving me in the direction of Christ? Are they sharing godly wisdom? A few years ago, I had a lady come in, and she had a marital problem. And really quickly, she moved from her marital problem to what her friends were saying. And it was so funny because she got into the kind of the, I don't know what you call it. But she got into the, well, my girlfriend said I should do this. And my other girlfriend said I should do this. And my other girlfriend, then she stepped in and said I should do it the other way. And my girlfriend, and I said, whoa, stop. I said, are they giving you godly wisdom? Are they helping you discover God's plan for your marriage? And she said, well, no, that's not what they're doing, but they're right there with me. And I said, whoa, hold on. Are they helping you? Are they helping you discover godly wisdom? Are they sharing? Are they imparting godly wisdom? And that's a question we all have to ask ourselves. Are the people that are advising us, counseling us, influencing us, are they leading us towards godly wisdom? Are they leading us towards godly wisdom? Ray Pritchard calls that 2 a.m. friends. 2 a.m. friends are the friends you call at 2 a.m. You say, hey, the world's collapsing. What do I do now? Do you have those 2 a.m. friends that are leading you in the direction of Christ? That's godly wisdom. The 2 a.m. friend that says, hey, let's pray about this. Let's seek God's plan here. Meet with me on Monday. We'll talk, you know, and they lead you in the direction of Christ. So number two, they share godly wisdom. Number three, and this one will baffle you. They will confront you. They will confront you. Now, I want to read the verse here, and there's a word in here we want to highlight. Here's the verse. It says, like an earring of gold or an ornament of fine gold is a wise man's, and what's that next word? Rebuke. Let's say that again together. Rebuke. One more time. Rebuke. Now, here's kind of the stem winder. You say, why would I bring somebody into my life to confront me? I mean, I've got a boss that can confront me. I've got a wife that confronts. I've got kids that can confront. I've got neighbors that can confront me. Why in the world would I bring somebody else in to confront me? I mean, that's the last thing I need. Somebody to confront me? Why didn't you put in there somebody that will encourage me? Somebody that will tell me how great I am? That'd be nice, wouldn't it? Just have a friend that tells you how great you are. That'd be good, wouldn't it? How many of you need one of those? Just tell, hey, man, you're so great at this. You're great at everything you do. But that's not God's plan here. Again, notice that word. It says, like an earring of gold or an ornament of fine gold is a wise man's rebuke to a listening ear. Oscar Wilde says this, a true friend stabs you in the front. We all need friends. Catch this. We all need friends that will stab us in the front from time to time. We all need people that will take the knife, look us in the eye, and say, you got to stop that. You got to cut that out. You got to do something different. Do we want those kind of people around all the time? Absolutely not. Is it what God says is a good thing for us? Absolutely. One of the greatest things we can have in our lives is a friend that will stab us in the front and say, whoa, you got to back up here. You got to go a different course. What you're doing now is not going to work. This isn't the direction that you need to go. Again, look, it says like an earring of gold or an ornament of fine gold. And then look at the very end here. It says is like a wise man's rebuke to a, look at that, listening ear. A listening ear. God tells us that we need those people around us that'll tell us the truth. That'll kind of confront us on what's going on. Then he says, you need to listen. You need to take it in. You need to be open and you need to be vulnerable enough to say, you know what? I need to hear the truth. I need to hear what this person has to say. Look at the next part of this. It says, Proverbs 25:13 here on your outline. A messenger you can trust is just refreshing as cool water in the summer. Basically saying, we need people to confront us. We need people to come and tell us the truth. And as they do that, that begins to move us in the direction in which God would have us to go. So we need to invite people, not just yes men, not just yes women, but people that will confront and say, hey, you got to change this. You got to look at this again. Man, this relationship you have over here, I don't know about that. This person you're texting, this person you're going to lunch with, I don't think your wife's going to like that. We need those kind of people to confront us and to say, you can't go there any longer. I told you about 20 years ago, I began to do this, and it's been great. I mean, this is I wouldn't change anything. It's been a great 20 years. But right at the beginning, I was down here. We had started a youth ministry, and I was working with that youth ministry. And speakers have a condition. And the condition is we always think we do a great job. If you were to ask us, you know, oh, man, I did a great job on that message. I mean, that was a home run. Everybody understood it. It was funny. It was a perfect message. And I thought that at the beginning. One of my first few messages as a youth pastor, I thought, man, I did great. I'm good at this. I'm a natural. And so after that meeting and after we had kind of been hanging around for a little while, the guy that was doing music at that time, he came up to me and he said, I want to talk to you about your message. And I thought, here it goes. He's about to heap it on, you know. He's about to tell me how great of a job I just did. And I said, go ahead, man. Tell me how good it was in my head, you know. And he said, I got a problem. Ugh, no, you're kidding. He said, no. He said, I got a problem. He said, your message was very unclear to me. He said, when you gave the gospel, it was incredibly unclear. And he kind of finished with this phrase. God doesn't want you to make his clear gospel unclear. He doesn't want you to confuse people with the gospel. And I remember that just kind of hit me in the chest. And it kind of took me back. But I've always remembered him kind of giving me that rebuke, kind of giving me that confrontation, kind of coming and saying, man, this isn't going to work. You got to change this. And it's been some of the most helpful advice that I've ever gotten as I speak. To be as crystal clear as I possibly can, and especially when it comes to sharing the gospel with people. Do you have people that can confront you? Do you make yourself vulnerable enough where people can come and say, wait a second. This ain't going to work. You need to check yourself here. Do you have somebody like that? I want to close with a story, and it's a story about a guy named Jack Hoffman. He's a five-year-old boy, and he came to breakfast one day. And when he came to breakfast, his mom and dad, immediately when they looked at him, they knew something was wrong. When they looked at his face, they could tell it was flush, and he was kind of, something was just bad wrong. They immediately took him to the hospital, and they began to run tests. A couple weeks later, they discovered that Jack had pediatric brain cancer. At 5 years old, Jack was a huge University of Nebraska football fan. And throughout his treatment, that was kind of a source of joy for him. He was able to kind of lean into his sports fanaticism, and that became a source of joy for him. The Nebraska football team heard about Jack. They brought him into a practice one day, and he was able to speak to the team. The team all got bracelets that just said, "Pray for Jack." That's what the bracelet said. Pray for Jack. In 2011, Nebraska was playing Ohio State. At halftime, Nebraska was down 20-6. One of the players had that bracelet on, and he walked up in front of the rest of the team, and he said this, "Jack's not giving up, and we're not giving up." Again, it was 20-6 at halftime. Nebraska was losing. They went back out after halftime. They ended up winning the game 34-27, marking the biggest comeback in the school's history. After the game, they called Jack, and they said, "Jack, you were our inspiration. Jack, when it seemed like there was really no hope for us, you kind of inspired us, and you're a huge inspiration and influence for us." They said, "Because that it happened, we want to reward you." And on the spring game in 2012, they brought Jack in, and I'm going to show you a video here in just a second, but Jack was able to actually join the team and to just accomplish something that's pretty magnificent. So if you'll turn your attention to the screen, okay?
And he's wearing the number 22, guys. It is Jack Hoffman of Team Jack coming out on the field right now. There's fourth down and short.
For the red team,
Jack Hoffman has been adopted really by this football team, a young man who has battled brain cancer. Is on the field right now for the Huskers.
One more snap for Taylor Martinez, too, who will hand it off to Jack.
So Taylor gets the shotgun set, gives it to Jack. Here he goes. He's got blockers out in front.
There he goes.
Jack is running to midfield. Listen to this crowd as Jack Hoffman, the young man, that, as I mentioned, has really been adopted by this football team, just scored a touchdown.
Oh, wow. What a moment.
And both benches empty.
That was a moment right there. Wow. Goosebumps.
All right. Wow. Let's give it up for Jack, right? And I show you that story or that illustration there because in a lot of ways, we can have people around us to help us like Jack had people to help. But not only that, Jack was a help to the football team, right? And in the relationships that we create and the people that we let advise us and influence us, we can help each other get to the next level. We can help each other go to a whole new level. And that's that power that God allows in our lives. You see, God is a great influence. God is a great advisor. God's a great counselor. He's called the wonderful counselor, as a matter of fact. But as a bonus, he puts other people around us that can be the same. There are other people around us that can be great advisors, great influencers, and great counselors. And so it becomes our job to say, you know what, I want some of those. I want to create something in my life where people are advising and counseling and influencing me in a way that takes me in the direction of Jesus Christ. Now, the great thing for you is that churches are a good place to start. Isn't that right? Wouldn't you think that a church is a great place to start here? And if you've never got involved in serving, if you've never got involved in a small group, one of the best decisions you can make is to do one of those two things or both of those things. Yesterday, we took 100 volunteers to a place in Atlanta called Impact or Maximum Impact Love, Impact Fulton. And those 100 people, after it was over, I heard people saying, "This was great. This was incredible. It was great to meet this person, and it was encouraging to talk to that person." And you saw that dynamic take place yesterday with the people at Impact Fulton. If you're in a small group, the same thing takes place. You'll inherently have people that are good at, that give good advice. They're good influencers, and they're good counselors. And so you're in the right place. Just access that. Get into a small group. Begin to serve. Jump in. God's doing some big things here. And as you do, you'll see that this part of your life begin to flourish and grow. That the advice that you're given, the influence that people have, will move you further and further in the direction of Christ. That's one of the incredible benefits of a church. So, there you go. Who are you going to let advise you? Who are you going to let counsel you? And who are you going to let influence you? Now today we want to honor some of our teachers and administrators. We're beginning the new school year, right? My little boy begins kindergarten on Tuesday. But here's what we'd like for us to do in here today. We want to pray for all of those people involved. So the first thing I'd like to do, I think some of our elders are in here and pastors, I'd like for you to come down front. And if you do make your way down, that'd be great. If our teachers, if you'd go ahead and make your way down front, and our administrators, we want to pray for you. Doesn't matter where you work, whatever, we want to pray for you. And before we leave today, we're just going to kind of come around you and support you. If you're a parent, here's what I'd like for you to do. Or a student, would you go ahead and stand up? Parents or students, would you just stand up right where you're at? And here's what we're going to do for you. Around you are some people that aren't standing up. And I want you to place your hand on those people. And for the next few moments today, I want us to pray for our teachers. Our teachers are some of the greatest advisors, counselors, and influencers that we ever have. And we want to pray in that end, okay? We want to pray for them. We want to lift them up. For our students, listen, you're beginning a new year. And we want to pray for you that you'll lean into godly advice, that you'll lean into influencers and advisors that will lead you in God's direction. Parents, we're praying for you too. Parents, we know, most people think that school is just for the students. No, parents have a big part in this, right? Would you say amen, parents? And so we're going to pray for our parents as they really have a challenge in and of themselves. And so here we go. In just a second, I'm going to walk down and we're going to pray right here. If you're not standing up, would you just take your hand and put it on a parent or student in front of you that's standing up? And we want to pray today, okay? So let's do that. Father, we're so thankful and grateful for our administrators and our teachers. Lord, you use teachers incredibly in our life. Lord, many of us can look back on some of the relationships we have with teachers and just remember the influence they had. Just remember the power they had in our life. Lord, we pray for these teachers today. Lord, do something supernatural in their classrooms this year. Let this be a year where they're just amazed at how well things go. They're just amazed at how you're operating in their classroom. Lord, their students are kind of living out the Christian life. That they're influenced. That they're walking in your ways, God. Lord, for our administrators, what a job they have to put all that together, to make all the puzzle pieces fit. Lord, we certainly lift up our administrators today, their long hours, their hard work. Lord, for our students today, Lord, it's tough. There's going to be some challenges, and there's going to be some heartache, and then there's going to be some just incredible highs that'll happen. Lord, but I pray that our students will seek wise counsel, that they'll look for good advisors and godly advisors, and that, God, those people will help them move in your direction. God, I lift up these parents. Lord, as parents of students, it can be overwhelming. And Lord, I pray that these parents will be a huge encouragement to their kids this year. That these parents will stand side by side with these students. That you'll empower these parents to be just a big help. Lord, and just in general, I pray that you'll do something big in our schools. Lord, our Christian school here, our public schools in our area, God, we're just praying for big stuff. We're praying for you to work and to move. Lord, we thank you, we know you can do it, and we think you will. And we're just praying for that today. God, empower everybody here today with your Spirit. Give them what they need to accomplish the task in front of them. And God, we give you praise and glory in Christ's name. Amen. Can everybody say amen? All right, let's give our teachers a hand. All right.